John, I have to ask you, of all of the campaigns, of all the creativity, of all the stories that you've told throughout your life, what would be your number one, most memorable, that you're in many ways most proud of?
You know, it's a great question, that, and it's like, it depends on what, when you wake up in the morning, what do you feel like, and what is it kind of, and I was lucky to be involved in many great campaigns, but I suppose the one that I get marked for most is Levi's, the launch of the 501 campaign here in Europe in now 1985. Oh my God, I just see 1985. That's another one from the last century, isn't it? But I think what was great about it is that it demonstrated the power of storytelling. It demonstrated the power of communication. It demonstrated how talking to a mass audience, because the problem with digital social media, I should say, because everything's digital now, is it talks to a narrow audience rather than a broad audience. And you need to talk to a broad audience. Even if somebody doesn't buy your product, it's important that they know about it. There's a lovely line that says, a brand is made not just by the people who buy it, but also by the people who know about it. That is fundamental to brand fame. Because if you have brand fame, it kind of increases the value of what you're selling, it resists competitive pressure, it allows premium pricing, all of those wonderful things. So brand fame is fundamentally important. A simple example for you, I am sure you and I are never ever going to buy a Rolls Royce. I'm sure, I would put money on that. However, we completely understand what it stands for. So there is a brand, Rolls Royce, that's made by people knowing about it. So when you see somebody driving it, you go, ooh, that's the most luxurious car in the world. Ooh, dear me, that's, you know, you might be impressed, but you know, that's what you're feeling. So you know about it. So the idea of broadcast is fundamentally important. So the reason the 501 campaign, which we launched in 85, really was significant because it changed the fortunes of Levi's. They were selling a 501 product that actually kids at that time, I use that phrase, it sounds condescending, doesn't it? But our target audience of sort of 16 to 20, the idea of Buttonfly was like, well, why would you want Buttonfly? Zip's much better, you know, and it was the wrong silhouette, which they talk about in fashion. However, we couldn't change the 501, that was it. But we managed to create a story around that product, use of music, that captured people's imagination. Now, the thing that made it was not only hugely successful for Levi's, they had to pull the advertising after 2 weeks because they couldn't keep up with demand. But it introduced the world to boxer shorts. And there's a story around that that I could go, I'll go into it and I'll tell you. When you get a script on television, it has to go through an approval process. You know, you can't just say anything you like or do anything you like. It has to be approved. When we submitted the script, we had this guy goes into a launderette, takes his strips down to his underwear, puts it all into the washing machine, sits down to a big man on the bench. Now, we had him in his Y-fronts. The script came back and they said, very sorry, that's indecent. You can't have a man taking his clothes off like that. It's indecent in a public place. And we said, but it's a pair of Y-fronts, you know, it's just like, you know, Speedos, swimming trunks. And they said, nope, very sorry. We were backwards and forward arguing, and they came back and they said, well, if you put him into boxer shorts, that would be okay, because they're like shorts. And we went, boxer shorts? That was that dodgy American underwear from the 40s. And we went, oh, okay, well, if that's going to get the script through, we will. We'll put him in there. So we put him into boxer shorts. Commercial runs. The sale of boxer shorts goes through the roof, you know. And I always say, Calvin Klein has never thanked me once, never even sent me a sort of like pristine pair of boxer shorts to say, well done, thank you very much. So it revolutionized that. Jeans, it revolutionized the way fashion occurred because of the 501 and the way you now wore clothes. And then it reintroduced great music from the sort of 50s and 60s, you know, heard it through the grapevine. And so it had this kind of profound effect on culture. And I think whatever you're doing, if you're an artist, if you're a painter, if you're a film director, if you're an author, you're not just trying to paint a picture, write a book, make a film. You're trying to affect culture. You're trying to be a part of culture. That's what makes a great piece of communication. And that's what it did. So I suppose, long story, sorry about that, but that was the work. And it then went on for about another 20 years, creating great ads that people talked about. You know, we had Brad Pitt in his, you know, before he became famous. We had directors who, Jonathan Glazer, who's just now done a brilliant movie. Do go and see it, Zone of Interest. It's absolutely fantastic, harrowing. Lesson to be learned there for everybody. And so we were able to work with Michel Gondry, and we did great, great work developing not only great stories, but working with great directors, Tao Sen. We went on to direct all kind of movies. So it was a fantastic campaign that touched many, many parts of culture.
Incredible, John. Absolutely incredible. Well, let's have a look at that commercial now. So look, I mean, frankly, at that point I started to wear 501s, and at that point I was wearing boxer shorts, and every single young person at that point would say exactly the same to you. John, it was absolutely mind-blowing what you did, absolutely mind-blowing.